Now, let me ask you this, because in a way, you're calling it the freedom dividend, so that gives individuals hypothetically more freedom. But here's what I worry about, and I'm not saying that this is something that you're proposing, but this is what I'm worried about post-Yang presidency. We pass UBI, you served two terms, you know, you've been president now, but we have a Republican administration, and what they tend to do is they pitch the idea of freedom, but oftentimes it's a Trojan horse to privatize social safety net programs. So let me give you an example. So Republicans often talk about voucher programs for healthcare, for education. Now, what is this in actuality? It's a ploy to privatize it, because if you devalue the utility of these types of social safety net programs, what happens? You open the door to privatization, because that undermines public support. And so here's what I worry about. If we get UBI and that kind of becomes the standard, it replaces food stamps for the most part. How can we protect what exists for the social safety net alongside UBI if people still opt for welfare instead of UBI simply because it benefits them more? Like, for example, my dad, it just benefits him to get, you know, the $1,300 from Social Security. So how can we protect Social Security if it's devalued because of UBI?
You know, this is a very legitimate and important consideration. And one of the things that I'd said to folks is that on the bright side, because very understandably, it's like, look, conservatives love to try and chop away at these programs, and like, might having the freedom dividend make it easier for them to do so. And then there is a contrary point of view that that this freedom dividend could itself become sort of like a tree trunk where you can't chop it because mm-hmm. everyone's getting it, and then you're like, okay, like, well, it's sort of hard to attack it. And the Alaska example is instructive, where, you know, they've had it for almost 40 years, and like, it's so popular, like, you can't touch it. And so there is like a trade-off. First, as you, I think, can tell, I would be the last person who wants to take away social programs from anyone. And certainly, like, you're right that it's possible that the president after me is then like, ooh, like, let me see if I can, you know.
Right. You can't be president forever. So that's what I'm worried about, is future administrations.
Yeah, it's a legitimate concern. The thing that I'd suggested to people is that you have to take a look at our current situation, which is that I'm not sure how hatchet-proof our existing programs are right now. Like, the conservatives have already successfully pulled back benefits in various in various states and various environments.
That's true.
And so it's not like right now, in the absence of the freedom dividend, these programs are bulletproof. A lot of people are actually very concerned about these programs' future. And the fear I have, if you look into, you know, what I think is coming with this wave of automation, is that the thing that's driving the hatcheting away of various welfare programs is this mindset of scarcity that is predominant. And unfortunately, it's getting higher and stronger as financial insecurity sweeps the country, more or less. Where then, if you have people who are struggling themselves economically, it's easier for conservative leaders to look at them and say, hey, guys, what's that? Yeah, we don't have enough money to go around. You know what we have to do? We have to get rid of these welfare programs for the people. Yeah. And then the people who are in scarcity are like, yeah, that's right. That's why like things aren't good, is because we're wasting money on these like other people. And that mindset is getting stronger and deeper and nastier all the time, because we're pushing more and more Americans and communities into economic distress.
Right.
So in the post-freedom dividend world, where people don't feel like their very future and their kids' futures are like in question, and then, you know, you get the economic boot off of people's throat, and they have a greater sense of abundance and future orientation, and maybe even like, you know, lower stress levels, then it's going to be harder to gin them up to attack and hatchet welfare programs. Because if you go and say, hey, these people are getting this stuff, then they'll be like, who cares? You know, like, mm-hmm. my life is fine. My kids are fine. I'm getting stuff.
Exactly.
They're getting some more stuff.
Exactly.
Like, maybe that's fine too. Maybe they need it. Maybe, you know, their circumstances are different than mine.
So this is what concerns me the most. And I'm supportive of UBI, to be clear. So if you are also kind of concerned with the same thing of future administrations getting in and, you know, using UBI to pitch cutting other social safety net programs, why not redesign your current UBI proposal to make it supplement existing social safety net programs? Because I think that would make everything, all of these problems that I'm bringing up kind of go away, because if it truly is universal, everybody gets it. Nobody's going to want to get rid of, in Congress, is going to want to get rid of UBI if it's so popular. And additionally, if it supplements our existing social safety net programs, then they can no longer use UBI. Republicans can no longer say, well, you have UBI, so you don't need food stamps. Let's cut that. So why not supplement what already exists? Why make it either or?
You know, I think part of it is that the way that the freedom dividend is positioned is that we're saying the right of citizenship now as an American is that you should be getting a floor of $1,000 a month. And that principle then, I believe, can make it very, very popular very quickly. And so if that's the principle, then you go to someone and say, hey, you know, you may already be receiving benefits of a certain kind. We're guaranteeing you a floor of $1,000 a month, doesn't matter what your situation is. And so, like, in an ideal world, like, if you gave me, again, a choice, it's like, hey, pass UBI on top of the existing social safety nets, like, you know, I would take that. but I believe that it's going to be more achievable. And again, we'd be talking about the alleviation of gross poverty in our time if we have it as like a blanket floor across the board. So, like, the question is a really interesting one. Mm-hmm. The way that I understood even the original basic income proposals, it was around this universal floor for everyone, and that's the approach that we've chosen.